In this video lecture, I'm going to do about half of topic 24, which was the cell cycle. I'm going to cover the first half. I'm only going to really kind of review over what cyclins are, cyclin-dependent kinases, and how they regulate the cell cycle. I won't cover mitosis, but you do need to know all the phases of mitosis and pay particular attention to the events that happen during anaphase A and anaphase B, because I really spent a lot of time covering those things. But that won't be the focus of today. So today we're going to do cyclins and cyclin-dependent kinases and how they regulate the cell cycle. So remember, the entire cell cycle is controlled by a general overall mechanism that we call the cell cycle control system. And this is not just one entire step. This is a compilation of many different steps that happen throughout the cell cycle to control progression through the cell cycle. And so, for example, if you look in G1 phase, before the cell moves on to replicate its DNA, it will stop at G1 and ask itself a question of, is the environment favorable to replicate? Do we have everything we need? Are the organelles duplicated? Have we grown in size? Because remember, G1 phase is where you get the majority of cell growth. Okay. Likewise, in S phase, you replicate your DNA, and in G2 phase, you also do a lot of steps to check replication. And so before you go ahead and enter mitosis, the cell wants to stop and ask itself several questions like, did I replicate the DNA properly, or is it damaged? Because once you get into mitosis, you can't correct anything. And then lastly, during mitosis, as you separate your chromatids into daughter cells, before the cell exits mitosis, the cell needs to ask the question of whether or not the chromosomes are separated properly and that the cells is far enough apart so that they can divide properly. Okay, so all of these different steps of telling the cell to start replicating, asking these kind of reflective questions of the cell, these are all part of the cell cycle controlled system. So the cell cycle control system is mainly regulated by checkpoints. And we call these checkpoints switches. And these switches are cyclin and cyclin-dependent kinase complexes. And these are heterodimer kinases. Okay, so they comprise the cyclin-dependent kinase, which is the catalytic subunit, okay, over here. What that means is that this is the actual part that has the kinase activity. And then cyclins bind to the cyclin-dependent kinases, and they regulate the activity. So they're called the regulatory subunit. Okay, so all of these checkpoints and all of these things that the cell does to turn on, say, cell DNA replication, or to go into mitosis, or even to separate the chromosomes, these are all controlled by these cyclin and cyclin-dependent kinase complexes. All right, so just remember, the kinase is the actual protein that phosphorylates a variety of substrates to actually tell the cell to start replicating. And then the cyclins are the regulatory subunits that regulate these kinases. So let's look a little bit more deeper at these two parts of the cyclin CDK complexes. So cyclin-dependent kinases are also called CDKs. Right, so I'll refer to that as CDKs mostly because it's easier to say. And their concentration does not vary in the cell. They're always made, they're always present, but they're not always active. So only their kinase activity is regulated, not their concentration. And we'll get into how their kinase activity is regulated later. Cyclins, on the other hand, they don't have any enzymatic activity. Okay, that's one key thing about them. But they regulate the cyclin-dependent kinases. So they'll bind to the cyclin-dependent kinases, and they'll help activate the kinase activity of the cyclin-dependent kinases. And we'll see how they do that, but what's interesting about cyclins and why they're called cyclins is that their concentrations in the cell varies from different phases of the cell cycle. So for example, certain cyclins will be made only in G1, and other cyclins will be made only in G2, and so on, okay? So the concentration vary in what's called a cyclical fashion, and that's why they're called cyclins. So you can see here a table showing some of the main cyclin and cyclin-dependent kinase complexes that are in the cell. And you can see they regulate all the phases of the cell cycle. For example, in G1, okay, there's a special cyclin called cyclin D that binds to either a cyclin-dependent kinase 4 or 6, and you don't need to know these specific names, but this is called the G1 CDK cyclin complex and cyclin-dependent kinase complex. And what this kinase does when it's active is it stimulates things in the cell to start growing and get ready for cell division. The G1S CDK complex, okay, is a different cyclin that binds to a different CDK. So remember, these are all different complexes that do different things. And what this complex does is it starts to get ready and turn on things for DNA replication. SCDK is another complex, and MCDK is the main cyclin-dependent kinase complex in mitosis. So the MCDK complex regulates all of the functions of mitosis. It tells the cell to start pulling the chromosomes apart. It tells the cell to start dividing physically. So each one of these is made only in certain, each one of these cyclins, I should say, is made only in the phases of the cell cycle that they're needed. And then once that cell, that phase is gone, these cyclins disappear. So the concentration varies in the cell. But what's key to understand is that each cyclin has a specific cyclin-dependent kinase partner that it binds to. Okay, so for example, cyclin E can only bind to CDK2. Cyclin A can also bind to CDK2 though. So the cyclin-dependent kinases have a variety of functions, but each cyclin has its own phase that it's made in, and it has its own specific function that it does, or that it controls. So here's an example of the cyclin and cyclin-dependent kinase complex that regulates mitosis. And what you'll see here is this is the actual kinase activity of the cyclin-dependent kinase in mitosis. All right, but remember, the CDK is always present in the cell. And so the kinase activity is only active when the cyclin, its associated cyclin concentration, it reaches a certain threshold. It's a certain point, and then that cyclin-dependent kinase becomes active. So over here, when you don't have very much cyclin concentration that binds to the mitosis CDK, you don't have any CDK activity because the cyclin has to be present for the cyclin-dependent kinase to be turned on. Okay, so once the cyclin gets made at the appropriate phase, it then can turn on its associated cyclin-dependent kinase. So here's the main mechanism that I want you to know on how cyclin-dependent kinases get turned on. And it's not just only the presence of the cyclin, but that has to be the first step. So the very first thing for the cyclin-dependent kinase to be activated is the cyclin gets made. Okay, remember the protein concentrations of these cyclins get made and then get destroyed and made again in a cyclical fashion. So the cyclin gets made and it binds to its corresponding cyclin-dependent kinase. So now you have a cyclin-dependent kinase cyclin complex, okay, but this kinase isn't actually active. All right? It needs a couple more things to happen. So the next step is there are other protein kinases, and we're not going to get into which ones, but they phosphorylate the cyclin-dependent kinase. Okay, so you have a kinase phosphorylating another kinase. All right, and this is key to many protein regulations. So these protein kinases phosphorylate the cyclin-dependent kinase on two sites. The first is an activating phosphorylation site. This turns the kinase on. The second is an inhibitory phosphate site, and this actually overrides everything and turns the kinase off. So this inhibitory phosphorylation event still makes sure that this cyclin-dependent kinase is turned off. And the very last step to actually turn on the cyclin-dependent kinase is you get an activating protein phosphatase. Remember, phosphatases remove phosphorylation. They remove phosphates from an amino acid. And so this phosphatase will actually remove the inhibitory phosphate here, right? And now you get fully active cyclin-dependent kinase cyclin complex that can now go on and turn on different things like S phase, okay, or mitosis or something like that. All right, so these things will go on and stimulate the cell to go into these different phases. So again, review. You have to have a cyclin made to begin with, okay, because the CDK has to be bound to the regulatory subunit. But just because the CDK is bound to cyclin doesn't turn it on. Then the CDK is phosphorylated at both an activating and an inhibitory site, and so that this kinase is still turned off, and then you get what's called a dephosphorylation event, that the result of the dephosphorylation event actually activates the complex. So it's what we call an activating protein phosphatase, because it activates this complex by making a dephosphorylation reaction. Okay, so I want you to know, I want you to be able to explain this general mechanism for how cyclins and CDKs get active. And remember, this is happening at each phase of the cell cycle. If we go back and we see this G1 CDK gets activated that way, all of them get activated that way. And that's what turns on different phases of the cell cycle. Because once these kinases are active, they now go on and phosphorylate all the necessary things to turn on maybe DNA replication or to turn on mitosis. What you'll notice in this figure that I showed earlier is that once you get your cyclin concentration to a certain threshold, your CDK activity gets turned on, right? And this starts doing its job, and it starts stimulating all the steps in mitosis. When the cell is ready to get out of mitosis, when everything's been completed and the cell needs to go back into interphase, you'll notice right here that the cyclin concentration drops very fast and rapidly. Okay, and this is what actually tells the cell to get out of a cell cycle or a phase of the cell cycle. If you kept the CDK activity on forever, you would be stuck in mitosis forever. So you have to have some way of turning off this activity so that you can move out of one phase and into the next phase. Okay, and so we're going to talk about how do you turn off the activity. I just told you how to turn on a cyclin-dependent kinase, but how do you turn it off? The main mechanism of turning it off is ubiquitination. Remember, this is the addition of ubiquitin, and these are ubiquitin subunits up here. Okay, and I'll just say UBQ for short, ubiquitin. And remember, these are small, about 80 amino acid polypeptides that get added to a protein. Okay, these are covalent modifications, and that targets the protein for destruction by the proteasome. Okay, so the way to turn these off, the easiest way to turn this off, is to get rid of the regulatory subunit, because remember, these cannot be active unless it's bound to a cyclin. So if you ubiquitinate the cyclin, you can destroy it, and this will now inactivate the cyclin-dependent kinase. And the nice thing about protein destruction is it's an irreversible process. Once you destroy this protein, it doesn't exist, and there's no chance that these will get turned back on again by accident. So it's a kind of a permanent way of turning this kinase off in order to turn off a phase of the cell cycle. So what will happen is during mitosis, this is active and doing some things, or maybe during the S phase, this is active and and regulating the replication of DNA. And once the DNA has been fully replicated, the cyclin is ubiquitinated and destroyed, and it turns off all of the processes for DNA replication, because you've already replicated the DNA and you don't need to do it again. And that tells the cell, okay, we're done with S phase, and then the other cyclins that regulate G2 will be made and turned on. And they'll turn on the CDKs for G2, and that'll stimulate the cell to move into the G2 phase. Okay, so you need a concurrent destruction of one cyclin complex and the addition of a different cyclin complex, and that's what moves the cell out of a phase of the cell cycle and into a next phase of the cell cycle. All right, so ubiquitination is the key mechanism. So protein degradation of the cyclins is the key mechanism for permanently turning off the CDK to move out of a phase of the cell cycle. So we've talked about how cells regulate movement into a certain phase. So for example, if you want to move into S phase, you'll turn on the what's called the G1 S CDK complex, and this is active and will start replicating DNA. Then you'll start degrading this complex very rapidly, and that will move the cell out of the S phase, and you'll start making a G2 CDK to move into the G2 phase, and so on, into mitosis. That's how the cell moves from phase to phase. On top of all of those mechanisms, The cell has multiple other checkpoints, where it checks for things that are happening within the cell. So this G1S CEK is going to stimulate DNA replication here in the S phase. Okay, when that replication has completed, the cell will stop for a second and actually check whether or not it's damaged DNA. Okay. Likewise, in G1, before it even starts to make the cyclin-dependent kinases to turn on the S phase, the cell will stop here and check for damaged DNA. You'll notice the cell checks a lot for damaged DNA because one of the worst things a cell can do is replicate damaged DNA. All of these checkpoints, okay, all of these little points where the cell can stop are done by what are called CDK inhibitor proteins. Okay, so this isn't telling the cell to move into S phase. This isn't regulating the complex itself through the mechanisms we talked about. These are additional proteins that can regulate an active complex, okay, and stop the cell in its tracks in order to maybe repair DNA or something like that. So they inhibit cell cycle progression, and they actually inhibit the cyclin CDK complex itself by binding to it. Okay, and I'm going to show you how these CDK inhibitor proteins do this. So these are the checkpoints where the cell can actually, let's say the cell is going through G1, it's growing really well, and the CDKs are active and they're doing their job, but the cell wants to stop because it sensed some damaged DNA. This is a mechanism of how the cell stops that. It's done through CDK inhibitor proteins. So here's the main example I gave you, and this is the example of P53. And so P53 is a transcriptional activator. What that means is that it goes into the nucleus and it stimulates transcription of certain genes and stimulates their production. Remember, like I said before, P53 is a very rapidly turning over protein, which means it has a half-life of about 5 minutes. All right. And so what that means is it's made for about 5 minutes and then it's destroyed, made and destroyed over and over again. Okay. Now, what can happen, though, is if you get any kind of DNA damage, let's say there's a break in your DNA or some mutations that the cell recognizes, it will activate certain protein kinases that will phosphorylate P53 over here and make it stable. All right, and now the P53 no longer has a half-life of 5 minutes. It's very stable and stays around the cell for longer periods of time. Well, when it stays around the cell for longer periods of time, what it does is it turns on its transcription activity, and it will stimulate the transcription of a gene called P21. Okay? And so with P53 around, it turns on P21, and P21 is a CDK inhibitor protein. Okay? So P53 turns on P21, which is the CDK inhibitor protein. And so let's say you're in G1, and here you have a G1S CDK, and it's getting ready to start replicating DNA. But the cell notices way up here that your DNA is damaged, and they want to say, stop, don't replicate the DNA. It does so by this mechanism. P53 is phosphorylated, activated, turns on P21 gene, P21 is made, and P21 binds to the CDK complex here and completely inactivates it. Okay, so the complex right now is active, currently active and doing its job. And when P21 is made, the protein itself will bind to the complex and inactivate it. And what will happen is it stops the cell in the G1 phase until it can repair its DNA. And then once it repairs the DNA, this inhibition is removed and this complex is now active to go on and stimulate cell division or DNA replication. Okay, so this is one mechanism. The CDK inhibitor protein is an additional mechanism that inhibits the complexes that are already active. Right? So if the cell finds that it can't repair the DNA, it'll stimulate apoptosis. And there's also another reason why P53 is so important is because replicating damaged DNA is one of the easiest ways to create a cancer cell. And in fact, over 50% of all cancers have mutations in P53. So it's a very important protein that needs to be regulated. If you lose P53 function, you can no longer check for or you can't really control the cell cycle and the presence of DNA damage. You won't be able to inhibit the cyclin-dependent kinase, and the cell will then always go into S phase, even in the presence of damaged DNA, which is not what you want. Okay, so that's the cell cycle control system. I want you to know how cyclins are regulated, or how cyclin and cyclin-dependent kinases themselves are regulated, how they work together, and the general mechanism for turning the cyclin-dependent kinase on. And then I want you to know the role of cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitor proteins and how they help control the cell cycle as well. Again, just email me if you have any questions on this, and I hope this cleared up some confusion you had on this lecture.